Good morning.
Interesting how loose this is then.
Yeah, it was tight to begin with, wasn't it?
We just left our anchorage on Samui. And we are heading to Koh Tao. That's 30 nautical miles. We're going to use Koh Tao as a jump point to head back to Pattaya because the next sail, and we're leaving tomorrow morning, is a 24-hour offshore passage. We're using this as a kind of mini shakedown to work out how to set the boat up effectively for shorthanded offshore sailing. The last time we did this, it was done with Nikki and Jason, and so today it's just the two of us. So first things first, stowing everything for passage at sea. The boat clearly is our floating home, but when we sail, we need to stow things. So that involves putting chairs away, making sure everything is in its place, making sure that the lockers are all stowed and ready, getting the sails set up, working, just doing engine checks, things that we need to do. Also, because it's 200 miles and it's offshore, not like we did last time, which was essentially coastal hopping, when we get to Koh Tao, we need to put together a grab bag that's going to contain things like passports, everything else, should the worst happen. Always good practice. Another thing that we have done is we have informed Phil, who is the delivery skipper, and the marina manager, Scott, that we are leaving at this time and that this is when we should be in. But we don't have an EPIRB on board because we couldn't get one because of some random regulations about Vietnam. So we have a PLB on board, but letting someone know that you are leaving and this is your ETA is good practice. We're not expecting bad weather, but just in case, we will pre-prepare a meal so that tomorrow night we have a hot meal that we can microwave. Spoiler alert, it's going to be pasta. It's always pasta. We have an apparent wind angle of 77 degrees, an apparent wind speed of 16 knots. We are full main, full jib, and we are doing 8.7 to 9 knots. Not bad. Anything to say, Skipper?
I think you covered it all, babe. Well done.
I'm Teresa, this is Nick, and this is Ruby Rose 2, our floating home. Join us as we settle into life on board our brand new catamaran, documenting our adventures and never shying away from the reality of boat life. Subscribe to our channel and leave a comment because we love to hear from you, and a big thanks to our community of patrons.
We are 10 miles away from Koh Tao. It's been a nice sail actually. The conditions are a little bit funny. The sea state is a little bit lumpy. It's lumpier than it should be for this kind of wind strength. So it's just a little bit of a confused sea state. So the boat's just having a little bounce. And we've got some very cloudy skies. So it's kind of one of those funny days where it's all a bit grey. The visibility is really murky. So it's kind of on paper not the best conditions, however, we're having a really nice time.
We've identified some minor issues with our mainsail again, and we think we know actually what the cause of the damage was to the sail on the delivery trip before we took hold of it. There is just some brackets on the boom that are causing a chafe. That's something important. We've already informed Seawind of what we believe the problem is now.
We've been having a little play and a little tinker with our sails because what we've come to realize is that trimming the sails on this boat is quite different to Ruby Rose, or I guess mana holes in general. And we're completely new to sailing catamarans, you know. We've sailed catamarans on charter a couple of times, but we've never really done a whole heap of sailing on cats by ourselves. I think one thing that we've come to appreciate is that the jib track and the main traveller play much bigger roles on a catamaran than on a monohull because they're much bigger. The main traveller takes up the entire width of the coach roof, and the jib track is also extremely wide, so they obviously have much more important roles to play than on a monohull. It's been interesting, it's been quite fun working out what levers to pull to get some good performance out of this boat. But we're pretty happy, so we have a 12 knots of true wind at 120 degrees. We have an apparent wind angle of 95, an apparent wind speed of 11, and we're doing 7 knots. Nice relaxing sail to Koh Tao, that's the idea. That's what we like. Thank you. We're here in Koh Tao, back on the mooring buoy. Looks like we've got maybe a little bit of rain coming our way. We'll see. It's feeling very dark. There's also rain right behind me there. And we can't see Koh Phangan anymore. That's meant to be behind my shoulder. So perhaps we'll get wet, perhaps we won't. But either way, I think we're done for today. We are just going to rest and chill. I've done a bit of laundry, so I'm not resting completely, but I am just going to take the rest of the day off and try and get some just downtime and some chill time before we go to bed tonight and have our passage back to Pattaya tomorrow. I've checked the forecast. One forecast model is saying there's going to be very, very light winds, like 10 knots and less, and the other one is saying it's going to be more like 15, 16 knots. So I'm crossing my fingers for the latter. We will see tomorrow. Either way, the wind is going to be in the right direction, so that's really the main thing. And with any luck, tomorrow and tomorrow night will be a nice passage. Let's cross our fingers. I'm ready.
Stop, stop. You need to go to port.
Okay, you're free.
Go. I think a little bit more halley tension.
Hello from about 5 miles away from Koh Tao. We have finally left the islands and we are heading back to Pattaya. We've been underway for about an hour now and we're flying the Screecher, as you can see behind me just there, and we've got the main up. Unfortunately, we're motor sailing at the moment. We really hope we can turn the engines off at some point soon. We're doing about six and a half to seven knots. We have a true wind speed of 14 knots. That's just started to come up a little bit. It's been about 11, 12 knots all morning. And we have an apparent wind angle of 140 and an apparent wind speed of 9-ish. Yeah, we tried turning the engines off. To be fair, that was about 20 minutes ago when we had more like 11 knots and now we've got more like 15 knots. So maybe we can try that again. And anyway, we only could make 4.8 knots of boat speed. We're happy to take our time, but you know, that's a little bit slow. And how quickly things change, because not that long ago, 5 knots was pretty good for Ruby Rose. We toyed with the idea of putting the spinnaker up, but the wind was fluking around a little bit in terms of direction. The Screecher is pretty happy at the moment with 130 degrees apparent wind angle. We may be tempted to put the spinnaker up later. Watch this space. I think the conditions are pretty good for it. We're just, you know, we've only been underway for an hour and we're just settling in. So we'll see how that goes. But for now, we are going to have a nice cup of tea and just enjoy the ride.
I want to try and get this engine up. So at some point, if we get stable wind, I can look at the graphs. So the true wind speed is 16 knots, which is exactly what we need. If we're getting sustained 14, 16 with a wind direction of 130, we should be all right. Just keep an eye on it.
All right, engines are off and we're doing 7.3 knots. 7.5, 7.6, 7.7. Cool, I'm happy with that. Apparent wind speed is 10, so we're doing 7.5 knots of speed in 9.5-10 knots of apparent wind speed. I'll take that. Can we have that for the next 24 hours, please? I'm on the bow. I'm very happy. I'm going to move to a spot where I can actually sit, and we're just going to have a little chat. Just you and me. So, I don't know, my feelings about this boat have been just really vacillating a lot, because moments like this I just think, oh my god, how good is this? It's so comfortable. I don't know, I've had a real knock of confidence actually recently. I have made some mistakes on this boat. None of them have been catastrophic yet, knock on wood, and none of them are like too stupid. It's just stuff that I am learning through making mistakes, how this boat is best managed. And I'm just finding the size of her difficult to get used to. I'm finding the blind spots difficult to get used to. I don't know whether there are any more blind spots in this boat than any other catamaran. I don't think so. But just the nature of the beast is that you have less visibility of the sails. And that means that when you're handling these sails, and these are huge sails, like, you know, our main sail is massive. Like, this creature is huge. Like, we've talked about putting in the spinnaker up this morning. At the moment, I don't think we're going to because we're sailing along quite happily, but our spinnaker is just ginormous. Like, I'm intimidated by that spinnaker. You know, the other day when we were putting the screecher out, I got a riding turn around the electric winch. The electric winches are scaring me quite a lot. Like, I started off being like, cool, electric winches, that's really helpful because, you know, we can't really do a lot of jobs on this boat without them. I've now come to the position where I'm like, I don't want to use this winch at all unless I absolutely have to. Like, they scare me. You know, the other day I was unfurling the screecher and you have to kind of come out of the cockpit and be sitting on the side deck to see the sail. You have to kind of stick your head out. But to do that, you can't really manage the winch at the same time. So the most comfortable, the most physically comfortable place to be is to actually be standing like on the side deck with like your foot on the electric winch button, managing the button with your foot, and then you've got full visibility of the sail. So that's what I was doing. And I tailed the sheet into the cockpit so that it would just go into the cockpit. And then I'm standing there and Nick's looking at the screecher and I'm looking at the screecher and it's coming out, it looks great. And I looked down and I'd had a riding turn in the winch the whole time. And the entire sheet was wrapped around the winch and I've never seen anything like it in my life. Like, I didn't film it because I wasn't filming that day and I wouldn't have filmed it anyway because I was just so stressed. But, you know, obviously we solved it. We put the lazy sheet, you know, through a block and around the other winch so that we could take the pressure off it. And then we were able to undo the riding turn. And there was a little bit of like fray, a little bit of wear on the line in a certain part, but it was okay. Nick just wrapped some tape around it. So, but that like really scared me. That freaked me out because I didn't realize, because there were no cues. There was no, like, I couldn't hear the winch struggling. You know, sometimes when you can hear when something's wrong because the electric winch kind of changes tone. Couldn't hear that. So those electric winches are just so powerful that you can do so much damage. I mean, we didn't on that particular occasion, but you could do so much damage in just like a couple of seconds and you don't even realize. So I'm scared of them now. And I know that in time it will become second nature and we'll know where to put ourselves and we'll know what to look for and it will be okay. But at the moment I'm just like, oh, this boat is stressing me out. It's stressing me out. It is. It's great. It's a great boat, but we've had some stress and, you know, it's just been a lot. It's been a far steeper learning curve than I ever anticipated. It's just been a lot. So frankly, I'm glad to be going back to Pattaya because we're going to get into the marina and that's going to be another hurdle trying to part this boat after a month of being at anchor. Anyway, deal with that tomorrow morning. And I'm looking forward to just being in the marina and getting some of those issues fixed and jobs done and to just kind of be tied up and not have to, you know, worry about coming back to my boat at 9 o'clock at night and have it being like a mile out to sea, for example. Oh God. But my point is that this is lovely. And at this particular moment in time, I'm very, very happy. Well, the spinnaker was nice while it lasted. Only lasted about 5 seconds. At least we hoisted it. And we had to do it a couple of times because we ran the sheet wrong. And we snuffed it, not without a little bit of drama because I let the sheet off too quickly and there wasn't enough tension, so it kind of was flapping around a little bit. Anyway, we got there and now we're back to square one. Now what do we do? Motor sailing. apparent wind speed of 5. And we're recalculating our arrival time into Pattaya, put it that way. Nick is off watch at the moment. He's having a little nap. And we're just cruising along. We've got the streets out, we've got the main up. It's one of those like overcast grey days, but it's actually quite nice because it's not too hot. There's a little bit of sunshine. Still got a nice little cool breeze coming through the cockpit. Not much going on out here. We're all by ourselves, which is quite nice. Without my love for the ocean, devotion brings me down. That without my love for the ocean, I will be no one.
Getting the boat ready for the night. You know, just getting everything stowed, put away, easily accessed. Checking the radar for squalls and setting the chart plotters up so that we've got one which has just got the radar, which is set to weather. You should pick up crab pots because there's a lot out here and they're all in 50 meters. Dinner was made last night, so it just goes in the microwave and ding ding. And then it's 6 p.m. by the ship's clock, which means that it's your watch. I'll do dinner at about 7 as per your instruction, and then yeah, we settle down for the evening, I guess. I'm hoping that the weather stays exactly like this.
So it's 7 o'clock in the evening. We've just had some dinner and the light is just about gone for the day. We are entering our first night on board Ruby Rose 2, our very first night passage. I'm on first watch. And we have the engines off for the first time in, I don't know, at least 6 hours, which is lovely. We are doing just on 7 knots. So we've just got the jib out and full main. It's been a good day. It's been a slow day, slower than we were hoping. I'm going to settle down and enjoy my first 3 hours of night sailing on our new boat.
Please, love.
Yeah?
I need you to ease that orange line about 6 inches. Got a hole in our mainsail, pull it through the block. Nah, we put a hole in the main.
Is that from what?
Pulling the reefing line too tight, and it's literally, there was a bit of sail there, we just pulled the sail line too tight.
We pulled it to where the reefing line mark was.
On the orange?
Yeah.
Okay, it's fine. Look, is this what it is? We have to get some patches for that sail.
I'm amazed you can actually see me. This is just the lights from the chart plotter and the nav gear, and they're on night mode. So that was all a bit exciting, not in a good way. I was just settling into my watch after feeling a little bit toey to begin with because, you know, getting used to a new boat and everything. Just starting to feel good about it. Could see the wind starting to build and I thought, oh, okay, that's fine. That's good, actually. Get some speed up. And then I realized it was from a squall coming our way. So I was just keeping an eye on things and then at the point where it started to kind of hit 20 knots more regularly, I thought, well, it's time to reef. So we've got Nick up, we reefed really well actually. I got, as you can see, quite wet. Yeah, put two reefs in the main now, and Nick's just told me that we've got a little hole in the mainsail where the block with the second reefing line pinched the sail. So we're super pissed about that. So that's gonna have to get patched up. But there's some more issues with the main anyway. So that's just the tip of the iceberg. Obviously, as soon as we put the second reef in, the squall passed and we're back to like 12 knots. So the engines are on again. We're keeping the second reef in because that might not be the last squall we have. I've got another 45 minutes left on my watch and then it's Nick's turn.
Thankfully, that was the end of that night's excitement. We settled in nicely to our night watches. I was woken up again at about 2 o'clock in the morning to take my final night watch after actually a really decent sleep. The boat was super comfortable underway. But this was what I was presented with as I came onto my second watch. It looked like we were sailing through an actual, very well lit up village. But in actual fact, it was what seemed like the entirety of the Thai fishing fleet. And I know it was just a tiny, tiny portion, but it just goes to show how many fishing boats are out here at all times. And luckily, most of them were really, really well lit up, as you could see. But there were a few that only had one tiny little light on. Luckily, we had the radar, so that helped a huge amount. And we escaped without, thankfully, getting too close to any of the boats. Dawn finally broke and we entered our second day under sail in really high spirits. Getting close now to arriving into Pattaya.
Morning. I am wearing one of the more eclectic outfits I've ever worn. Yeah, the temperature's dropped. I'm quite cool. So we have just finished our first night of sailing on board River Rose 2. I did 6 p.m. till 9 p.m. Nick did 9 till technically 12, but he let me sleep in until about 12:45. And then I did 1 until, I think I let Nick sleep until 4:30. I did get him up at 3 to help me with the fishing boats because there were some that I was struggling to identify. So I just needed an extra set of eyes. Yeah, so I went down at about 4:30 and then I woke up just naturally at 7 and I woke up and I saw Nick in the helm position here and he was literally going like this. So I said, back to bed with you. I also have coffee, so that's starting to kick in now, which is lovely. It's 7:45 in the morning and we are about 30 miles away. I can see land, which is lovely. Running kind of downwind now, so the jib's not particularly happy, but she's out anyway. Yeah, nice little following sea there. And that's about it really. It's not a lot happening. Thankfully, that's what we like. We like boring passages. I know exciting passages are more interesting for you, but yeah, we prefer the boring ones. So, first night passage done?
Yeah.
How was your night?
Well, a game of two halves. It's, what is it? It's about 10:30 in the morning. We've been at sea now for 25 hours. We've got about an hour and a half to run. It was, I would say, an average night passage, maybe a little bit more difficult than normal. Firstly, and well done, Terysa, you were on watch. You picked up a squall on the horizon, picked it up on the radar, and we reefed down, got the boat stable.
Just in the nick of time.
Got a little shower, got a little drenching, so that was good. I'm pretty impressed with the technique. Pretty on the ball.
Yeah.
In fact, the weak link of that was that I'm like, I came out of quite a deep sleep and I'm like, which way am I turning to port or start?
Really
It was doing everything blind because I'm trying to work out where the lines are. I'm turning a flashlight on, destroying my night vision.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's doing it blind.
Yeah.
But anyway, look, the reef went in perfectly well. Yeah, our reefing technique is good now.
Yeah.
I think that as another positive, we have really started to get familiar with this BNG system.
Yeah.
And I think the BNG halo radar is pretty amazing. I think I can't remember our old system, but on this, literally, you can just set it to weather or to offshore. I would say about 11 p.m., I think you were asleep. I just literally sat with my head out the cat flap and thought, this is amazing. This is a really lovely night sail. You know, we were batting along at about 7 knots, two reefs and a jib fully out. You know, the boat was just going along really comfortably and I was very, very happy. And then about midnight, we were about 50 miles offshore from the major township or the major city out on the coast. And we literally just hit the fishing fleet. And the fishing fleet I don't know what they fish for, but they use lights. And so last night was literally just dodging fishing boats. They all fish in a stationary position. So they just put their lights on and just haul up nets. But I would say that I don't think it's an exaggeration to think that last night there must have been, if you say we sailed 30 miles, we must have had 200 fishing boats. Luckily, I on my watches only had to alter course once, and we had the radar, and a lot of them don't have AIS, so you're relying a lot on radar. The fishing fleet That went on from about midnight till 5 a.m.
Yeah.
And it's pretty tiring, actually. Yeah. I came back on to watch, I think, at 4:30 this morning. By 7:30, I was just on my arse.
I know.
That was pretty hectic. And, you know, we've got the swell pushing it along nicely. We're doing between, I don't know, 5.5 and 7.5 knots. And the boat is very, very comfortable. Like, all I would say is, you know, difficult night, but the day bed is very, very comfortable. You know, and we always knew that when we got this boat, we'd use the day bed for the off watch, so that we're always, and you know. But there's nothing quite like having my toe shaken at 2 a.m. saying, I need your help. There's a squall coming. I mean, like, here we go again. I'm always a little.
What are you
going to
make? Have
a night one?
Have a night sail?
I'm not. I think I was. I'm just going to. I actually thought about that. I was going to say no, but I thought actually I was quite anxious about it. I kind of did feel. Going into your first night sailing a new boat, you do realize you have to do things differently, that you are looking at having to deal with issues like refraction on glass that maybe give you a false view of where boats are. You have to literally, in a very short space of time from essentially when you put the boat to bed for the night and go into night mode, have to understand very, very quickly light pollution, where everything is. I'm not being pessimistic, but as skipper, and we were having this discussion on our Discord server and our WhatsApp server for our patrons the other night about what's the biggest size boat you can handle. And I think this is really important. 60 foot is fine until something goes wrong. It is. I think that, for instance, we are learning yesterday, and I'm sure this has been on camera already, putting the asymmetric up. We haven't done it since we had, you know, Mark from Doyle doing it, which is great when you've got like the owner of Doyle putting the sails up for you, because you're like, okay, well, you know what you're doing. But hoisting the asymmetric, just getting it up there without a power winch, and then unfurling it and furling it and unfurling it and furling it, because we got the lines tangled a few times. This is the limit of my strength. You get people that are much stronger than me, but I think I found it is exhausting. Like, you come off that and you're like the trampoline, you're dripping with sweat, you're like, Christ, that was hard. So yeah, I kind of like, it's like, well, what if it goes wrong? What if this? And it's not pessimism, it's just you have to scenario plan for what do you do if this happens, which is the reason we have a grab bag. I was stressed. I feel a whole level more confidence in this boat now and how we work. And I would say that on offshore passages, I would want another pair of eyes. And therefore, patrons, we'll be doing offshore passages with you very, very soon. Anyway, if you enjoyed this episode, give us a like, give us a thumbs up. Have a lovely afternoon. Goodbye.
And don't forget to subscribe.